All right, let's figure it out.
Well, so first off, I think the first thing, if I'm right, is, so is the following statement true? Once we know four of them are right, we will stumble onto the right answer when we do the neighborhood?
Well, so, okay, so that's a good idea. So we could actually do one more step and see what happens. So, yeah, because in this particular case, because of the fitness function is the way that it is, the number of correct bits, there's always a neighbor that is one step closer to the target. So right. We're always going to be incrementing as we go.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a very friendly fitness function. Mm-hmm. It's only a global optimum.
Right. So do you want to do that? And then maybe we could talk about how we could have been even more clever. So let's just pick the first one. Okay. And so now we have to do the fourth one. So it's 10110. And then the fifth one is 10101.
Good. All right. So if this is X and these are the neighbors of X, these are the scores. And it turns out that one of them actually has all five matches. So that was, in fact, the pattern I was thinking of. Here, just to prove it. 10110. And if we now continue the search from here, all the neighbors are going to be worse, obviously.
Right.
So how could we have figured out the sequence without that extra information that I just gave you?
Well, if we look at the two that have four, we can basically just see that where the they must have three in common, which they do. One, the first, the second, and the last one.
Okay.
And each is off by exactly one. So that means that, well, since I know the answer, I know that you just take one. You just take one from each. So either they both have to be ones or they both have to be zeros.
All right. And so do we know that the 0-1 doesn't work?
We probably know that the 0-1 doesn't work.
Because then the answer would be 10000. 10000, which is exactly, we already know is a 3.
Right. So then it has to be 10110, which in fact it is.
Which it was. Cool.
Right. So this was in fact a very nice fitness function. And you know, it seems to me that we had a nice little advantage here in that we really understood the structure of our space. But if this were a 5,000-bit sequence where the fitness function was some weird thing, where, in fact, we didn't even know what it was, we just knew that there was one, then that would have been a whole lot harder. Actually, here's a question for you, Michael. If I had given you this, but I didn't tell you what the fitness function was, just that when you gave me a sequence, I evaluated it for you, we wouldn't have been able to do any of the stuff that we were doing. I mean, we'd still be able to do it, but we wouldn't have been able to jump ahead like we could have done with those two that were four, because we wouldn't even know what the maximum fitness value was.
Yeah, we would have had to have done this last step to find that one of them has a score of 5. And then we would have had to have done that step again to make sure that there wasn't anything locally better than 5, because we wouldn't have known that if we didn't have a kind of semantic understanding of the fitness function. But the rest of the algorithm was perfectly implementable without knowing that, right? All that you were basing your decisions on was you gave me bit sequences, I gave you scores, and you used those to figure out what next bit sequence to ask. It didn't use the fact that the fitness function had a particular form.
That's right. That's right.
Now, in this one, this particular problem is very, very well behaved because it has one global optimum, this bit sequence that has a score of 5. Nothing else had a 5. And once you're at and no other bit sequence actually could you be stuck, right? So it was always the case that you could always get closer to the target pattern, so your score can always go up. But in general, that's not how things work, that you may actually be able to get stuck in local optima, and we need a way of dealing with that.